whether a woman should still have the constitutional right to end her pregnancy of her own accord. At the Supreme Court in Washington today, the two sides of that argument were joined in front of the nine justices, eight men and one woman. Throughout the land for months, those who oppose abortion and those who insist a woman has the right to make her own choice have been doing everything they can to influence the court. Today, the final process of making legal history began. Our law correspondent, Tim O'Brien, was there.
The Supreme Court appeared to be under siege this morning, opponents of abortion shoulder to shoulder with chanting abortion rights activists.
Women will decide our fate, not the church, not the state. Women will decide our fate.
Dozens were arrested for crossing police lines. People from all over the United States had begun lining up yesterday in hopes of getting a seat for what could become an historic argument. At stake is the future of Roe versus Wade, the 1973 ruling in which the Supreme Court said the right to an abortion is guaranteed by the constitutional right to privacy. The case before the court involves this Missouri law that defines life as beginning at conception and prohibits any state funding for abortion or abortion counseling. Missouri's Attorney General told the Supreme Court today if those provisions are inconsistent with Roe v. Wade, then it's the Roe decision that should be thrown out, not Missouri's law.
What is before the court is the right of Missouri and to determine how public bodies in our state are going to expend our monies.
Missouri was backed by the Bush administration in urging that Roe be overruled. Charles Freed, the former Solicitor General. We are not asking the court to unravel the fabric of individual privacy rights, Freed told the justices, just to pull out this one thread. When I pull out a thread, my sleeve falls off, responded Attorney Frank Sussman, representing the St. Louis Abortion Clinic, challenging the Missouri law. Sussman suggested if the right to privacy doesn't guarantee abortion, the right to use contraceptives, which the court has also based on privacy, might be the next to go.
We're only talking about one right, the right of procreation and the right of a woman to be free from interference by the state to make these kinds of decisions at either end of the spectrum with her physician.
The outcome could easily turn on the views of President Reagan's three appointees to the court. Justices Scalia, Kennedy, and O'Connor dominated the questioning, but provided no clues as to how they might vote. Surely one of the most interested spectators today, Norma McCorvey, who used the pseudonym Jane Roe when she successfully challenged the Texas abortion law in Roe v. Wade 16 years ago. Should McCorvey's landmark victory now be reversed, each individual state would decide for itself whether to permit abortion. Court scholars say the justices are more likely to chip away at Roe, making it more difficult in some states to get an abortion. The justices will actually decide this case in a regular secret conference this Friday. The formal written opinion, however, will not be released until late June when it officially becomes law. Tim O'Brien, ABC News, Washington.
Those demonstrators you saw outside the court today were a reflection of what was happening elsewhere in the country. Pro-choice demonstrators gathered on the steps of the California State Capitol and in other cities as well. Anti-abortion groups confronted the demonstrators in cities like Miami. They, however, say their major demonstrations are going to come on Saturday. And now the sad and quite unexpected news from California. Everyone knew that Lucille Ball had been ill, and everyone felt immensely relieved when it appeared that Lucy was doing better. Well, today she died suddenly. She was 77. Here's ABC's Ken Kashibahara.
At Cedars-Sinai Medical Center, Lucille Ball's death this morning was sudden and completely unexpected. Since her heart surgery a week ago, the hospital had been flooded with letters and get-well cards. And indeed, she appeared to be recovering, talking, sitting up, even walking. But today, a hospital spokesman said a part of her cardiac system not involved in the surgery ruptured.
There was no reason to suspect that anything was about to occur.
As word of Lucille Ball's death spread throughout Hollywood, fans gathered at her house.
We thought we'd take a ride by her house, just sort of a tribute to her.
We will miss her a lot, and she's a legend, and there'll never be another Lucille Ball.
Along Hollywood's boulevards, foreign tourists remembered growing up with Lucy and her late husband, Desi Arnaz.
Actually, I learned to speak English with Lucille Ball.
Lucille Ball's last public appearance was at the Academy Awards a month ago, where she appeared with Bob Hope.
You know, we made four pictures together.
Yeah, talk about dangerous liaisons.
She was a friend. We loved her dearly, and she's truly going to be missed.
As a clown, she was unsurpassed. It's difficult to even think of any men who do that kind of humor who one would say were better than Lucy.
I love Lucy. Everybody loves Lucy. The whole world is... She's gone, but she's still here.
But perhaps the most spontaneous tribute came from a man who stopped his car on Hollywood Boulevard simply to touch Lucille Ball's star. Ken Kashiwahara, ABC News, Hollywood.
It isn't at all hard to see Lucy on television these days, and at the end of this broadcast, we'll take a glimpse at just how she did it. She was never cynical, and she was always fresh. How often can you say that these days? Also on the broadcast tonight, an environmental debate you won't see.
We'll always live.
Lucy?
His mother has some friends coming over to see her tonight, and I offered to press her dress for her.
Well? After the annulment, you can come and live with us. I didn't mean it, honey. I was only joking.
Please don't make jokes. You're the only English-speaking friend I've got.
Madam, did you stop this train by pulling that handle?
Well, I didn't do it by dragging my foot.
I did.
What?
The back of the train.
The robe, George.
Lucy, why don't you tell the truth?
Yes, Lucy, tell the truth.
Oh, shut up. If I'd known there was anybody in there, do you think I'd be fool enough to come over here and... Ah! Ah!
Well?
Oh, when he gives me saxophone lessons, he turns the music.
I'd particularly like to thank that incomparable creative family that was always close at hand during all those wonderful years.
Lucy, always on television, always in our hearts. That's our report on World News Tonight. I'm Peter Jennings. We'll see you tomorrow. Good night.